Good evening.
Last night I spoke about Parashat Balak. I'm still behind, didn't get to Pinchas yet. Hopefully today I'll be able to do it. And I finished yesterday with coming to the famous pasuk of the parasha that it's very, very common verse in today's world. Am levadad ishkon uvagoyim lo itchashav. It's written in a prophecy of Bilam. As you know, Bilam came to curse, but he ended up blessing because Hashem switched his curse into a blessing. And this is what later in Sefer Zvarim, in Deuteronomy, when Hashem say, you owe me big time for changing the curse of Bilam into a blessing, meaning that really should have been a curse, and also meaning that the curse should have been really, really painful, meaning it will cause a damage. And because I love you and I love your father, I turn the curse into a blessing. So from here we learn that we really got saved. And the second indication is that Hashem had to cover us, that Bilam will not be able to see us, that he cannot put his evil eye on us, meaning that he had powers. No, he cannot deny it. But before I'm going to explain what is the meaning of some of the verses in his prophecies that apply to us even today, especially today, I should say, let's give a little bit of understanding about what's going on here. As you know, when Moab saw that the Jewish nation won against Sihon Melech HaEmori, the Amorites, and Og, which was also one of the kings of the Amorites, Og Melech HaBashan, and they left nothing from them. They totally destroyed them. So Moab, don't forget, Moab came from whom? From Lot. Amon and Moab is two boys that were born from the nephew of Avraham Avinu. So technically it's very interesting, it's like we cousins, right? Lot is the nephew of Avraham, and his children is Amon and Moab, Shnei Mamzerim, illegitimate boys from his daughters, right? And who is his uncle? Avraham Avinu. So we are actually family with them. And those are some of the worst goyim in the world. Because even among the Gentiles, there's different level of goyim. Some goyim Hashem likes more than the others. Just like by the Jews. Some Jews Hashem likes more than the others, depend on their actions. Hashem doesn't like a Jew more than the other because he was born in specific country, or because he dressed different, meaning different customs, as long as they dress modest, or because he has a different accent, or because of his last name. This is nonsense. This is pure racism. And Hashem is not a racist. He created all people, and he loves them based on their actions. Even by the goyim, when Hashem loves some of them more than the other, it's not because of the color of their skin, or because from what country they're coming from. It's 100% because of what they did. If Amalek did horrible things, Hashem put an X on them. If Ishmael was a wild beast, Pere Adam, Hashem put a stamp in the Torah that the Arabs that came from Ishmael is a wild beast. That's it. Not because Ishmael was somebody that Hashem didn't like from birth. No, because of the way he behaved, Hashem put an X on him. Same thing as Esav. It's written clearly. I love Et Yaakov Avti. I love Jacob, ve'et Esav saneti. And I hate Esav. Now, why I hate Esav? What reason I have to hate Esav? He's a twin to Yaakov. They both came from Rivka, and they both the children of Yitzchak. Why would I hate one and love the other? Not because he is red and the other one is dark? It's, of course, nonsense. The only reason I love Yaakov, because he's Ishtam Yoshev Oalim, Bachur Yeshiva, learning in yeshiva day and night, learning Torah, have good personality, I love him. Why I hate Esav? Because he's a hunter. He likes football and baseball and NBA and clubs in Manhattan and go fishing and eat not kosher food and go to the bars and all day in the internet. That's why this kid I love and the other one I cannot stand. Pure and simple. Nothing because of the way you look or I made you to hate you, God forbid. No, your actions put you in a status that you are. Same thing us. Each one of us has a different status in the eyes of Hashem. Regardless what you are, Litvish, Hasidish, Yemenite, Sfaradi, Baal Tshuva, not, right now who you are, Ba'asher Husham, you are a tzaddik, you're righteous, you're shomer mitzvot, you're a lover of Hashem, you're honest, or you're a crook, a deceiver, not modest, liar, stealing, all these things that some people do. If you are in a right positive direction, your status in a very high mark. If Hashem Yirachem, you one of these Jews who everything they do is the opposite of the Torah, your status is in a very bad situation. If you die today, you have a very serious problem. If you die righteous, you're in a very good position. There's nothing to worry about you. Very righteous, you go to heaven, you go to very good places. We spoke about it hundreds of times. So now, after they saw what Hashem did to this nation, Sihon, Melech HaEmori and Og also, they were afraid that the Jewish people will take control over them and make them slaves. Because back in time, when one nation won against the other, you didn't have all these Geneva laws and the United Nations and exchanging prisoners. It wasn't like today, it wasn't organized. So if we take over your country, we make you our servant. You're gonna have to cut trees for us. You're gonna have to work for us. You're gonna have to pay us taxes. We will collect taxes. This is what the Romans did to us. When Nebuchadnezzar came, in the beginning, he didn't kill us right away. He made us pay tax. And Gedaliah ben Achikam, Gedaliah was the governor. He took a Jewish rabbi that he saw that he's an honest person. And he said to him, this is how much tax you have to pay me every year. As long as you pay, I don't touch you. The problem is that the traders, the Jewish traders, were starting to make problems. And then in the end, when the Bavlim, not the Romans, the Bavlim, they saw that they actually rebelling against them. Then they came and destroyed everything. And the rest of the story is history. So we see over here, that some of these empires, as long as you pay them, they leave you alone. You want to rebel, you stop paying, next thing they come, they take prisoners, they kill people, Hashem Yirachem, and they destroy the Beit HaMikdash. Over here, the same thing. When the Jews went into a war with the Philistines, they had an idea. So why should we kill each other? Both sides would lose thousands of people. You get your best soldier, we get our best soldier, let them fight each other. If we win, you will be our servants. If you win, we will be your servant, meaning we will pay you, right? So they brought David against Goliath, one-on-one. And Baruch Hashem, David won, and the Philistines became under the hand of Israel. It wasn't always like this. Sometimes it was the other way around. So now they're very worried that the Jews will take over their land. They're very worried. So even though they were prisoners of Midian, which is another nearby nation, they decided to have a meeting with them. How should we win against Israel? Don't forget that Moshe Rabbeinu, where did he grow up? Some of the years that he grew up and became who he became was in Midian, because he ran from Egypt, he ran to Midian. That's where he met his wife, Yitro. So they come to Midian. How should we win against them? And the people of Midian, who personally knew Moshe Rabbeinu, they said the power of these Jewish people and the power of Moshe Rabbeinu is in their mouth. Our power is in our hands. The power of the Jewish people is in their mouth. They're not physical, they're not warriors. Their power is in their mouth, meaning they are very smart. They use their head, they know how to talk, They know how to convince. They're very smart people. You cannot win with them just because you are strong. You have to have the right strategy. So the elders of Moab, they saw in Midian Balak ben Zippor, who grew up in a city called Petor, that it's in Aram. Where is Aram? Where is Aram? You have two parts of Aram. You have Aram Tzova, and you have Aram Naharaim. Aram Tzova is Syria. If you look at the Syrian Sidurim, the Syrian community here, on their Sidurim, it says, Keminhag Aram Tzova. Aram Tzova means Syria. What does it mean, Aram Naharaim? That's Kurdistan, Iraq. Where the Kurdish people between Iraq and Syria, on the border between Iraq and Syria, that's called Aram Naharaim. The first Jew, the first Hebrew was Kurdish. Who was he? Abraham Avinu. If somebody asks you, tell me, Rabbi, where the origin of the Jews? They all came from Abraham Avinu, who was from where? From Iraq, Kurdistan. Right? So even if now you're Polish, or you're German, or you're Russian Jew, meaning Ashkenazi, or you're Chusid, remember, your grandfather was Abraham Avinu from Iraq, Bavli. We all came from Bavel. That's the origin of the Hebrew race. Later, of course, we all were Egyptians. When we went to Egypt, that's when we became a nation. So, as you can read, the whole story was more or less in the Middle East area. Syria, Iraq, Israel, this whole area. Now, so they come to Balak ben Zippor, who grew in the city of Ptor, which is in Syria, in Aram. And what now is a prince in Midian. They ask him to be their king. Come be our king. And Balak decided to come fight the Jews with same method that the Jews are good in, with the mouth. The Amorites, they try war head to head, they lost. What should we do? We should fight in a smarter way. Let's get this prophet of the Goyim, Bilam, to curse them, to put a curse on them. Same thing, they are good with their mouth, we get someone that is good with his mouth. So he's a magician, black magic, and he's from the same city. They two buddies. They both grew up in Syria, Ptor. Bilam and Balak. And he knew him already there, that he has power. And he is the one who actually told him when he was young that one day he will be the king. The king in Moab. So when he saw that now they came to offer him the job, come be our king. It's very, very rare that a nation will call a stranger to come be their king. Imagine, I once had an idea that Israel should ask Rudy Giuliani to be the prime minister of Israel. Definitely will be better than all these fake righties in Israel. Back in town, you know. Now I would offer Trump the job. If he won't get reelected, I would rather he be the president of Israel, the prime minister, than to see all these cowards who sits there in the government and argue if we should give salary to the Arab terrorist or not. This was the debate yesterday in the Knesset. Half of the government, close to 60 people, they voted to pay a salary to the Arab-Palestinian murderers who murdered children. That we, the Jews, will give them a salary for sitting in jail. Can you believe it? Did you ever hear such nonsense in history? The Jews are not known as dumb people. But something is happening to us in the last 20, 30 years. We lost totally our common sense and logic. So barely, finally they canceled this law to give the terrorists money. You understand? Not that they won't give them money. They'll give them money, but now they will deduct it from the taxes they collect from Palestinian merchandise. The Palestinians do not have a port. So they use Israel. So once they come to Israel, we collect the taxes from them, whatever the thing is. We collect the taxes from them, we give them money every month. It's very interesting because they get electric from us, but they don't pay for it. They owe us billions already for electric. But the Israeli lefty government do not want to disconnect their electric because it's not humanic. You understand? Here in America, you don't pay the electric, they don't care who you are. You can be as far as a congressman. They disconnect your electric. Humanic, not humanic. It's democracy. Nothing personal, Mr. Congressman. You don't pay your electric, you don't get electric. Here, you supply electric to the murderers who declare every day they want to kill you. And they don't pay, and you continue to give them electric. In the middle of the war, some smart politicians say, cut the electric. They use the electric to kill us. We're in a war now. Thanks to the electric, they make these rockets and shoot at us. At least now cut the electric. No, you cannot do that. Why? Let them kill us. It's more humanic. More humanic that they will shoot missiles at our children, that we're gonna cut their electric, you understand? So if you put someone like Trump or someone else, at least they're not dumb. They'll know what to do. You deal with these enemies, we'll know what to do. Okay. So here you go. They came, they bring Balak to be the king. And he brings this Bilam. Why he count on him? Why he count on him? Because he told him that one day he's gonna be the king there. And this came true. Also, in Milchemet Sichon, when Bilam blessed Sichon that he will win against Moab, it also happened. So now he already saw that Bilam twice was successful, twice. So he's counting on him. Balak, he sends an important group of people, elder from Moab and from Midian. All of them are good magicians to impress him, conquers the Jews. Bilam, of course, said, I'm gonna make it very short and brief, just for us to get an idea before I go into the details. He said, stay here at night because I cannot speak to God unless if I go to sleep. The only one who can speak to Hashem face to face is Moshe Rabbeinu. He's the only prophet. Everyone else have to lay down to sleep. That's the only time they can get a dream and Hashem tells them what to do. So, the elder of Midian, they realized that he cannot help them and they left. The elders of Moab, they stay. They're afraid of him. How are we gonna go back? Okay. In the night, Hashem came to him, just like with Adam and Cain. What's mutual between Adam and Cain when Hashem came to speak to them? Hashem doesn't come and attack a person right away. He starts always with the question, hoping that the person will confess. Because confession is a large portion and a condition for the tshuva, for repentance. Did you eat from the tree I told you not to eat? Or when he came to Cain, he didn't say right away, why did you kill your brother? Where is your brother? Hoping he's gonna say, I'm sorry, God, I killed him. I didn't know, I hit him and he died. What did he answer? Am I his guard? I'm his keeper? Why are you asking me? Trying to lie. When Hashem came to Adam, did you eat from the tree I told you? He didn't say, yes, I'm so sorry. I don't know why did I do such thing. The woman that you gave me, it's her fault. So Hashem said, who are these people? Hashem doesn't know who these people are. He asked Bilam, who these people are? Why? He wants Bilam to say, I'm so sorry, they came to ask me to curse your children. But don't worry, I have no intention to go with them. This was the right answer. Bilam said, from the fact that Hashem is asking me such a question, probably he not always know everything. This God has some limitation, God forbid. Sometimes he knows things, sometimes the computer has a glitch. It doesn't work maybe, you know? The computer engineer that designed it messed up. You understand? Not you, relax. You never mess up. But the one who made the computer, that's how we think. That's how the goyim, by the way, think. There is a big question if God knows the future. How can you even ask such a question? Someone who made such a world and controlled so many details, do you ask if he knows the future or not? Is this a legitimate question or not? There are three opinions about it. The opinion of the Jews, the opinion of the Greeks, and the opinion of the Muslims. Three different opinions. Why there are three different opinions among the scholars of Islam, among the scholars of the Greeks, among the scholars of the Jews? Three different opinions to one question. How can it be? Next question we have to ask, the Greeks, they were not stupid people. They were great mathematicians, philosophers. They were asking a lot of questions about life. The Muslims anyway copy everything from Judaism. So how all of a sudden they disagree with the Jewish opinion? The question is, first, before we answer the answer, is this a legitimate question or no? If somebody asks you, if your child come to ask you, does God know the future? He doesn't dispute the fact that he made the world. In learning yeshiva, in first grade, Bereshit bara Elokim et hashamayim ve'et ha'aretz, he already know how to sing it all day. So he understands. But now he comes with a good question. Is Hashem knows what I'm going to do in the next hour? Or I can surprise him? Huh? The question is legit or no? It's a smart question or a stupid question? What do you think? Huh? Again, you're not answering my question. Smart question or stupid question? Most of the questions I get from people over the years, at least 80% of them are very stupid questions. It comes from ignorance or it comes from people who have no common sense. But sometimes the people ask very good questions. See, they're very clever. They have good common sense. So the question is, this question comes from a good point, from wisdom, or it comes from stupidity? Nobody knows? Huh? The answer is both. In one hand, it comes from wisdom, and the other hand, it comes from stupidity. Can you be wise and stupid at the same time? Yes. Yes. I give you an example. Some people, they have fantastic memory. Every Gemara they learn, they remember every name, every detail, everything. But they never ever understand the Gemara all the way deep the way it is. Because their brain has a limit on their sharpness. In the Gemara, they ask a question, what's better? Someone who memorizes a lot, or someone who memorizes less, but is very sharp and understanding everything very clear? It's called Sinai and Oker Arim. They have two expressions. Sinai, it's like similar to Mount Sinai. Oker Arim means able to take the mountain out of the ground. Meaning that's how much he digged inside and he's smart and he goes and check further and further and further and all the little details becoming more and more clear. You need a very, very sharp brain for that. Not everyone has it. I've seen yeshivot. I had many students over the years. Some of them always understood how far the question goes. And they understood what bothers the Gemara. Sometimes there's a silent kushiyah in the Gemara. Not all the kushiyot in the Gemara are clear question. Sometimes from a comment the Gemara make, a clever person understand what bothered the Chacham that put it in the Gemara. Some people will not see it. They won't know. They won't know why the Gemara made this comment. You can ask him 2 hours. But why the Gemara say it? I don't know. Because they don't understand what bother the Gemara that they had to bring it here in this exact place. So you see, not everyone is sharp as the other. But some people have a lot of memory. They remember a lot of things. But to explain that clearly, they can't. Some people, they explain very good, whatever they learn, they're very sharp, but they don't have large knowledge. So what's better? The Gemara ask, what's better? There's advantages here, there's advantages here, okay. The point over here now, how can this question be smart and foolish at the same time? Why it's smart? Because there is a contradiction in the understanding. If you're going to tell me that God knows the future, what the conclusion that comes out of it is that we are robots. We don't really choose anything. Because the moment you came to the world, you already knew how we're going to finish the world. So technically, we could never ever choose something that is different than his knowledge. Because he already knew how we're going to end. So if he knows how I'm going to end in 80 years from now, that means that I never had any other option to end somewhere else, because he already saw where I'm going to end. That means that my entire life is a game. I don't choose whatever I say, whatever I do, whatever I eat, whatever happens to me. It's all was already a part of a movie, and nobody asked me. And that's a very big problem, because all the verses in the Torah, even the Goyim admit, that God says, be careful not to do this and be careful not to do that. I will punish you severely because you did such and such. I'm taking away what I gave you, or I will not give you what I told you. So obviously you see from the interaction in the Torah, we lost a lot because of our behaving. We lost what we should have got. We lost what we had. And we actually, God has a lot of complaints against us for not doing what he commanded us, meaning that it was 100% in our hand. If it was not in our hand, what do you want from me? You made me like this. You made me do it. You made me. So that's a very big problem. So the Goyim ran into a serious problem. So what was the conclusion of the Arabs, the Muslims? Because of this contradiction, they could not understand how can it be. So they said, everything is min Allah. Everything is from God. Whatever we did, whatever we say, whatever happens, had to happen. It's not in our hand. Then you have to come back to the Muslim and ask them, excuse me, Mr. Mustafa, I only have one problem with your conclusion. If you believe that everything is min Allah, why you execute people? Why you cut the hands of the thieves? You yourself said that God made them steal. Poor kids. They went and stole a piece of bread because they're hungry. God made them steal. Why you chop their heads off? A woman who cheated, God made her cheat. Why you stone her to death in Saudi Arabia? All these things that happened, why do you take actions against people when you yourself say everything that happened meant to be? It had to be. It's a total contradiction. Okay. What the Greek says? The Greeks say God does not know the future. He controls the world, he runs the world, he made the world, yes. But he doesn't know the future. Why? For the same problem. How can he know the future? If he knows the future, we don't choose. We're robots. The Jews say God knows the future, everything, with no limit. And we choose 100% what to do when it comes to spirituality. When it comes to physical condition, nobody asks us what. This is what was determined for us, and that's it. There's nothing you can do about it. But when it comes to be righteous or wicked, and to make the right choices that will make you righteous, or the wrong choices that will make you wicked, is 100% in your hand. הכל בידי שמיים, חוץ מיראת שמיים. If to be צדיק או רשע, לא נאמר, the Gemara says. Every person will determine his own future, if you be righteous or if you be wicked. Depend on your actions. So how do you explain? But still, God already knew if I'll be righteous or wicked. Before I was created. He already knew it's going to be this person named such and such from this city, from this town, who will be born in this day and will die in that day. And he already knew if he will die righteous or wicked. So if he knew he's going to die righteous, he basically had no other way. He couldn't be wicked. And if he knew he's going to die wicked, there's nothing he could have done about it. So in that case, why there's punishments in the Torah? Why the Torah say, I'm giving you the life and the good, the bad and the death, and you should choose life. Meaning you can choose the bad and death. The Torah say, choose the good. The Torah say, be very careful not to choose the bad. The Torah say, if you're going to do what I told you to do, I will reward you. If you're not going to do what I told you, I will punish you. Why? You already know what we're going to do because you already decided it. What do you want from us? Not only you already force us to do things, now you're coming to reward or to punish us. So we see that because the Torah is warning us not to do certain things, and before the Torah, because the Torah used the language choose, that means it's 100% in our hand. If it was not in our hand, we never found that Hashem punish a person because of the way he looks. If you're born blonde, you're gonna get a punishment. If you have green eyes, you're gonna get a punishment. Imagine if the Torah say, everyone who was born with green eyes, I hate him. Everyone will say, come on, this cannot be a divine book. You made the people with green eyes, now you hate them for that? Doesn't make any sense. You can hate someone for choosing to be evil and a murderer. Why you hate Hitler? He chose to be a monster and to kill people. Oh, if you say I hate him because he has black hair, that's stupid. It wasn't in his hand. I hate him because he was, 6 feet tall. That's stupid. You cannot hate a person because of the way he was born. Asian, white, black, this color of eyes, that's shtuyot. This is the way Hashem designed him. You can only be upset at someone for choosing to be evil and wicked. And you can love someone and admire him for choosing to be righteous. But if it was not in his hands, you should never hate him and you should never love him. It's like looking at the wall. You love the wall. You hate the wall. If you hate the wall, I have a good psychiatrist. If you need, I'll give you his number. You understand? So the idea here is, how do we still understand the fact that Hashem knows the future, but we still choose 100%? The answer is, Rabotai, very complicated. The Rambam writes that the answer to this question is wider than the ocean. If you take all the 72% of the world is water, put it in a pen, so much ink, and try to understand all the scenarios, how it works, it will be wider than the entire ocean to understand how it works. And we as human beings don't have the capacity and the ability to understand how it works. But I can give you a very good answer that hopefully will give you an idea what's going on here. Hashem is always in the same mode of time. In our world, we have three dimensions, meaning of time. We have the past, we have the present, and we have the future, right? Yesterday is the past. Right now is the present. Tomorrow is the future. Everything in our life, you can put a sticker on it. Past, present, or future. Your bar mitzvah, past. Your wedding, next week, future. Everything is either past, future, or present. But the present is so short, before you move, it's over. Okay. By Hashem, there's no such thing, past, present, and future. Everything by Hashem is present. Why? In a second that Hashem, because past, present, and future exist only where material exists. We are in a world of material. The time, like the way we measure it here, is a result of the speed of light and the movement of Earth and the movement of the galaxy, as the movement of the moon, as the movement of everything around, as results of that, and the 17,000 kilometers per hour that the Earth goes around itself, this was designed that a day will have 24 hours of 60 minutes an hour. If the speed of Earth will be slower, right, the day will be much longer and the night will be longer or shorter, depends. Also, it's depend on the movement of the Earth around the Sun, which meaning the year, the entire movement of the year. So that's determined the time in our planet. Because Hashem is not a part of material, even though He created material, and it's some kind of a system like a simulation. We are in this world. When Hashem made this world and He determined that this world will be for 6,000 years, the same second that Hashem made the world, that second the world was already finished for Him. Can you understand something like this or not? Do you understand the logic of what I'm saying or no? Since Hashem does not have past, present, and future, that's why His name is in the Torah, is Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei. Yud, Hei, Vav, and Hei. Why those four letters? Because those four letters give us the combination of three times. Haya, the past, Oveh, the present, Yehye, the future. The three times in the name of God, meaning to show you the past, the present, and the future is always the same by me. We cannot understand that. Why? Because Hashem designed us in this world and put us here in a place of a test. And the Torah that He gave us, the Torah itself depends on time. Everything in the Torah connects to time. When to put tefillin, only when it's light. When to do brit milah, only when it's light. When to do kriyat shema, 3 hours from sunrise, or after the stars appear. When to do, when to celebrate Passover, from this date until this date. Everything in the Torah connects to time. Everything. There's not one thing that is not subject to time. Everything in life is connected to time. Every movement, every word, every step, sleeping, waking up, eating, going to the bathroom, walking in the street, thinking, everything connects to time. But the way Hashem designed it, that by us we have the past, we have the present, and we have the future, meaning, what we already did, we have to check if we did the right thing, and if not, to make repentance, regret, be ashamed, and accept never to repeat again. So the past is still very important. Now we have the present, what we have to do next? Right now, what do I have to choose? Every second I have a test. What to choose? To come to the shiur? Not to come to the shiur. To stay until the end? To live in the middle? To listen or to play with my phone? There are many, many choices every second. Okay. Now the future. Tomorrow, what will I do? There's an opportunity to do big mitzvah. If I want to do it, I have to start preparing from now. I have to call the driver, come at 9 o'clock, take me to the place. I have to go, you know, do something. So it's already starting in the plan right now. And we're going to action later on. So we see everything in our life, it's either still connect to the past, or the present, or the future. Because Hashem is not material, for Him there's no such thing, past, present, and future. So the dimension of time is totally different than Him. It's true that Hashem matched Himself to His creation, and He goes with us according to the time of year. And by the way, the judgment, when we die, will be exactly like here. And the Gemara says, if the Mishpat Reshaim, בגיהנום יודבט חודש, 12 months, it's 12 months, like here. Not 12 months that are unlimited months. 12 months exactly like here. And all the things that it's written, in Chazal about time in the next world, it's all like here. Same thing like here. This is the language we do understand. And also it has to be measure for measure, exactly like what it was here. Everything has to match what we did here, for good and for bad. But Hashem, the way he created the world, that second the world was finished. So that means when he created me right now, for him, he already see the end of the movie. The movie will be 6,000 years. And I will go from one body to another. I will be in body A, 70 years. Then I go to body B, 80 years. Then I go to body C, 40 years. Then I go to the next body, 90 years. All the bodies, different places. Sometimes a man, sometimes you are a woman, sometimes you are a Kohen, sometimes you're Sfaradi, sometimes you are Ashkenazi, sometimes you can be Temani, sometimes, God forbid, you can be an autistic kid who live very short life or Down syndrome. This is all the reincarnations that you came to the world. Hashem, the second he created you and you put in a Shama in the body for the first round, for him, he already see after all the reincarnation what you chose. That's what it means. It's like Hashem can travel in time. He can travel in time. For us, we don't have a way to understand it. That's why the Rambam said, even if I will write you an answer that is wider than the ocean, you will still have difficult time understanding it. But one thing we do know for sure. Hashem told us in the Torah, you are choosing everything. And the Rambam writes, don't think what the fools of the Goyim and the fools of the Jews are saying, that it was predetermined for you to be righteous or wicked. There is nothing who pulls you to the righteous side, and there is nothing that pulls you to the wicked side. You are choosing 100%. You want to learn Torah or not? You want to invest or you don't want? You want to speak Lashon Hara or you want to stop with that? Every one of these choices is 100% yours. Every choice you make affects your eternity. One choice. I'll give you one example. The Shatran is calling you now. Reuven, yes, I have two girls for you. Tell me which one you want to date. This girl from this family, she went to Beit Yaakov. She's very righteous, she's very modest. She's down to earth, she has fantastic personality, but she's not so pretty. Average look, not ugly, not pretty. The other girl, she comes from a very rich family, and you know, she also went to yeshiva, but she's very modern. She's not so much into religion. She loves materialism. She wants fancy life. She wants a lot of vacation. She wants a husband, you know, to entertain her. She doesn't mind he will learn an hour or two a day, but that's already enough. That's it. More than that, she doesn't want. But she's very, very pretty, and she's very, very rich, and her parents will help you very much in financial. You don't have to worry. They're going to buy your house. They're very, very wealthy. Which one of the two you would like us to set up the meeting? He's thinking. He said, okay, I want the pretty girl, the rich girl. Set it up. So now they send him up on the date. The girl is nice. They have attraction. They like each other. After a few dates, Baruch Hashem, they decided to get married. That second that he made the choice, how long did it take him? 2 minutes. He was thinking on a phone call. There is either Sarah or there is Rivka. He chose Rivka. If he would say Sarah, that second, they would set him up with Sarah, he would also love her. And his entire eternity will be different. Not only this life from age 20 until age 80, every second of his life will be different. His entire path will be different. His next life will be different. If he will have to come back again to the world in reincarnation, this will be as a result of the choice he made 60 years ago. Now he died when he's 80. He made the choice when he was 20. 6 years later he died. He comes to Hashem. He has his trial. Hashem wants to send him back to the world to fix more his neshama. What family Hashem is going to send him? How is he going to be born? How is he going to look? how much money he's going to have, how healthy he's going to be, how smart he's going to be. It's all connected to the choice he made 60 years ago that took him 1 minute. 1 minute choice affected billions of things in his life and his next life and the next life. It's all a chain reaction. Chain reaction. So if something bad happens to you today, it's very possible it's something because of something you did 500 years ago. Obviously, you have no way to know. We have rules how to handle bad things. But to know 100%, you don't know. And the reason you don't know 100%, because if you know 100%, it will interfere with your free will. I'll give you an example. When you lose money today, you lost a lot of money, bad day in the stock market, crashed. I don't know, you lost $50,000. You're under panic now, what am I gonna do? Wow, another day like this, I'm done, that's it. Now you begin to think, why Hashem did this to me? Why? You have 500 options. Maybe because I'm a liar. Maybe because I'm a thief. Maybe because I'm a cheap husband who chokes his wife and doesn't let her breathe. Maybe because I'm stingy and I never buy gifts. Maybe I'm a tough father. Maybe I never give tzedakah. Maybe I collected interest from Jews in my life. Maybe I'm a bad son to my parents. Maybe I make problems for my neighbors. Maybe I do not learn Torah seriously or not enough. Maybe I'm not strictly kosher and Hashem is giving me a wake-up call. Maybe, 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 maybe. So many maybes. You don't know which one. But you know that Hashem is upset at you if he gave you such a punishment. So you begin to wake up to do tshuva and try to fix. Now, because you don't know what you've been punished for, you try to fix many, many things. You don't know why. So you try to be a better son. You try to improve yourself as a father. You try to improve yourself as a husband. You try to be better Shomer Shabbat. You try to learn more hours Torah during the week. You try to learn more serious. You shut your phone. Maybe you get rid of your bad phone and got a kosher phone. Lots of good things came to your life thanks to one punishment. Since you did not know why you got the punishment for, you fix 50 things out of the 500. If Hashem will tell you every time he punish you what you are being punished for, at best case scenario, you would only fix that particular problem and nothing else. So the mercy of Hashem is to hide from us why he does things. Same thing when he rewards us, when something wonderful happened to us in our life. A miracle happened to you. You don't know why Hashem made you this miracle. Maybe it's because I give a lot of tzedakah. Maybe because I help miserable people. Maybe it's because I'm a great father. Maybe it's because I behave 100% like the Gemara say to behave to the wife. Maybe because I come to shul at 5 a.m. to pray very early. It's a blessing. Maybe because of this. Maybe because I'm a good son. Maybe because I'm a good boss. Maybe because I always have patience for people. There's so many possibilities. Since I do not know why, I continue to do a lot of things because maybe it's because of this. I don't want to take chances. But if I know every time Hashem give me something great, it's because I give a lot of tzedakah, that's all I would do. Why bother with the others? So far Hashem gave me nothing for it. So this will eliminate totally the free choice. Totally will eliminate the free choice. That's why Hashem doesn't tell us. So going back to the question, the people that ask if Hashem knows the future, in one hand, it's a smart question, because if he knows the future, how am I choosing? The people who already know Hashem knows the future because it's written clearly. Who can give me a source in the Tanakh that from here we know that Hashem knows the future? Now, I'm going to tell you by common sense, and that will explain why it's also a stupid question. By common sense, it must be that Hashem knows all the future. Must be. Who can tell me why? By common sense. before we go into the Tanakh and bring a source. Why? By common sense, it must be that Hashem knows all the future of all the people in any given moment. You can say that the prophecies is the things that Hashem does know, but there's many other things he doesn't know. Prophecy shows us what Hashem did know, but psychic also knows some things. They say 100 things, and 2 or 3 of them came through. That's not an indication that Hashem knows all the future. I want a proof from a human logic, from common sense, how we know for sure, that Hashem knows all the future, and there cannot be any other way. The answer is, Rabotai, if Hashem had the limitation of not knowing the future of some people, he would not be able to reserve and guard the world. If Hashem didn't know if these crazy Iranians will do something, if they have a bomb and they will use the bomb, maybe they're only threatening, it would affect all the choices that he makes right now. This is something that will happen in 10 years from now, but you have to prepare the world for it from now. You won't be able to protect the world once it's happening. If all of a sudden something like this will happen and it caught you not ready, it's too late to save the world. Because remember, there are trillions of transactions every second in the world, and they're all connected to each other. If the butterfly here in Brooklyn moves his wings, in 2 weeks, it will affect Mr. Lee in China. And how Mr. Lee will react will affect Mr. Chang. And how Mr. Chang will react will affect Muhammad in Saudi Arabia. And how he will react, it will affect Ahmed in Israel. And Ahmed, how he will react, will kill 30 Jews, God forbid. What's the connection? Only if you know all the future and predict what's going to happen or not happen, you are able to control and maneuver the world the way you want the world to be. If you have limitation about knowing the future, you won't be able to be successful. This is what we say, Ine lo yanum velo yishan shomer Israel. Hashem is always on a guard, every transaction is supervised. Who can bring me a source from the Tanakh that Hashem does know the future? Who knows? It's written in a book of Samuel that King David asked Hashem while he was on a run from Shaul. Shaul is chasing him to kill him with his soldiers, and he's hiding in caves. And he wanted to go to a city called Bet Hanun, somewhere in Israel, city of people. He asked, not Bet Hanun, Keila, with Ayn. So he asked Hashem, can the people of Keila, will they turn me into the hand of Shaul or not? And Hashem told him, yes, they will. You see, Hashem already see the picture, even though it doesn't exist yet, that they will turn him in. There are other examples in the Tanakh that Hashem already say about what's going to happen or what can never happen. For instance, in the Talmud, we learn that Hashem say that every seafood that you want to eat must have fins and scales in order for it to be kosher. So if you see fins and scales, it's kosher. Now the Oral Torah, the Gemara say, I'm going to teach you now a secret. You don't really need to. If you see scales, you can eat it. Even if you don't see the fins. For instance, if you see half a fish, you don't see the fins. You only see the head and a little bit from the body. And you see scales, they fall off. Where is the other sign? You don't know. Maybe this fish didn't have scales, maybe had a tail. How do I know if it's kosher or not? I need 2 witnesses, but I only have 1 witness. The Gemara say, if it has scales, for sure it had fins. I will never let any creature, any species in the water to have scales and not to have fins. You can be sure about it. No one will ever be able to mix species and create a species that have only scales that will not have fins. I will never let it happen. Every time you will see something with scales, you can eat it. Guarantee it's kosher. Why? I know the future, I control the future. I'm telling you, with all the scientists that will mix all different kinds of fish, I will never let it happen. I give you another example. The Torah say, I'm bringing you into Israel and I will throw the seven nations out of Israel and I'm going to give you the land. Not because you're righteous or because you deserve the land, no. Because I promised to your father, Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and that's why I'm going to give you the land. And the second reason why I'm giving you the land, because the Goyim who lives in Israel are worse than you. So when I have bad and worse, I rather take the bad. Bad compared to the worse is good. You are nothing perfect, but compared to these filthy Goyim in Israel that are all idol worshippers and all kinds of other crimes that they do, compared to you, they're much worse. So take the promise I made to your fathers, the righteous Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. On top of it, add all the sins that this Goyim made and I cannot look at them anymore. I throw them out of my land and I'm giving it to you. But at the same time, if you won't listen to me and you get me angry, I will take the land away from you and I will throw you out of there. Ki li haaretz, I am the master of the land. Ki lo timaker haaretz letzmitut. The land, you don't have an ownership, a policy of ownership that it's for life. No. You can only sit on the land as long as I want you to sit in the land. If you don't listen to me and you go against my rules, I will make your enemy that live among you rise and you go down. They will take pieces of your land. And if you still continue to go against me, I will throw you completely out of the land. I will destroy my home and I will sell you to be slaves in the end of this filthy, cruel Goyim. All these things that were written in the Torah about the future, all happened. We did get the land. Hashem kicked seven nations out. He gave us the land. We built a temple. The temple was destroyed. By whom? By a nation who came from far and we don't know their language. The Torah also describes who is going to destroy the temple. A nation that their symbol is eagle. Eagle. Very interesting. The Babylonians, eagle. The Romans, eagle. The Americans, eagle. The German Nazis, eagle. The Russian, eagle. All of them, eagle. It's unbelievable. And the Torah already told you that way before this nation becomes powerful, that they're coming and they're going to destroy the land, and this is going to be a nation not from your neighbors. A nation you won't recognize their language. They come from far away and they sell you to Egypt. And they send you to Egypt with boats, and nobody would be interested to buy you as a slave. All these prophecies are written in the Torah, all of them happen. Even though, remember that these prophecies are against all odds. The chance that something like this will happen by itself is 1 to 1 billion. But all of that happened. I give you another example. The Gemara promised that the Western Wall will never fall down. The Gemara say on Midrash of Shir HaShirim, Midrash Rabbah, Hine ze omed achar kotlenu, here is our wall standing, that Hashem swore to this wall that they will never fall down. Even though the Goyim knocked down the other three walls twice in history, and from then until now, 2,000 years of wars in Jerusalem, earthquake, all kinds of problems, the wall is still standing. How the wall is still standing? What connects the bricks of the wall? Nothing, there's no cement. When you build a house, you put cement between the bricks. That's what keeps the bricks standing and attached to each other. It makes it all one piece. Try to build a house putting bricks without cement. One wind, the whole house will fall. All the walls, everything, the floors, they won't be able to stand. What keeps the house standing and the walls is the cement that you put between the bricks. The wall is big bricks standing one on top of the other, and there's no cement. And there was a massive earthquake in Jerusalem who wiped out the entire city. And the goyim build one thing on top of the other. There used to be generation that the Western Wall was buried under the ground. They found it in archaeological digging. They digged and dug it inside until they found it and cleaned it, and now you see the wall. It was in the ground. And there is not one empire who did not occupy Jerusalem and destroy it, and somehow all of them left the Western Wall standing. Who can give such a promise? This wall will never fall down. Who? You know, human being that can write such a guarantee in a book. Who will take such a risk? So you see from here that not only Hashem knows the future, Hashem designed the future. And the way Hashem designed the future is based on the past. It's not coincidence. Some plan is predetermined. Like, for instance, that the world will be 6,000 years. Whether we're righteous or wicked, the world is maximum 6,000 years. This was decided the day Hashem made the world. How people would look, hands, fingers, eyes, nose. This was decided already before the world was made. Oxygen in a world. Hashem designed the world like this. All the things that we see, animals, trees, fruits, everything was designed. According to Kabbalah, this is the seventh world. There were already six different worlds. Each world had already 7,000 years, just like this world. 6,000 years of creation, like 6 days of Bereshit, and one day Shabbat, the day of strike. 7 times 7, it's not Shemitah. That's when Mashiach would come. ביום ההוא יתקע בשופר גדול, they blow the shofar in a 50th year. So you have one world for 7 years, finished, destroyed. Hashem created world and destroyed them. And now a second world, a third, a fourth, a sixth. We are in the sixth world right now, which is about to finish. We are in the last quarter from 24 quarters of the creation. We are 5,778 years into the creation. We are very close to the end. And Chazal already told us that at least 200 years before the end, the salvation will begin, meaning in 22 years from now, within 22 years. So we are mamash in Erev Shabbat. Erev Shabbat of the seventh world. Seven cycles on Shnat Shemitah. Every Shabbat, Shnat Shemitah, like here. 6 years, 7 years, Shnat Shemitah. A year of Sabbath, 6 days of the week, the 7 day Shabbat. Seven worlds, six worlds. Six are past, now we're going into the next one. What is it? When Mashiach come, we have 1,000 years for the Shabbat, like the year of Shemitah and for Yovel. And after that, no more physical worlds, and the souls go to life of eternity, Olam HaNeshamot, and that's it. There's no more tests, no more nothing. Everybody gets his reward in the eternal world if you get there. Depend on how you behave. And everything go achar achitum. Everything will be decided how you finish your reincarnations. So now it's basically perhaps the last chance of each one of us to be a tzaddik. If we mess up now, we may not come back anymore. If Mashiach come and we don't resurrect in the resurrection of the dead, that's it, we finished. We won't come back, we won't have Olam Haba, nothing. This is how critical the situation is now. That's why the world is a mess. Everything is a zoo. Tons of tragedies, tons of crisis in Emunah, so many problems, so much kfira, internet fighting against the Torah, so many wicked people, so many Jewish traders, Erev Rav, who betrayed Israel, help our enemies, fight the rabbis, fight the Torah, try to destroy Judaism, just like the Zohar say, that Be'acharit Hayamim, in the end of days, the children of this Erev Rav, converts that Moshe took out of Egypt, will come back to the world in every generation to give us hard time, but the hardest time will be just before the end. Just like giving birth to a baby. When does a woman suffer the most? Today she became pregnant. She doesn't feel anything. Walking, running, playing, jogging. When will she feel the hardest pain and pressure and screaming and going crazy? The closer she gets into giving birth, when Hevle Leda begins, she has contractions, she begins to scream. In the beginning is every half an hour, then every 20 minutes, then every 10 minutes, then every 5 minutes, then every minute, then every 20 seconds. And then they begin to scream, push, screaming, going crazy. I hate it, I wanna die, kill me, get out of the room. And the boy came out, the Mashiach came out, and the happiness began. And all the, this is exactly what's happening right now. Why? Now we are in the last day of the pregnancy. When in the world is suffering, Chevle Mashiach, problem, Gog u'Magog, big war was about to start. Who knows what can happen any minute, but this is exactly according to the plan. So let's move back to what I started to explain. So the question, in one hand, is a smart question, but on the other hand is a foolish question, because common sense require that Hashem cannot miss one transaction, not in the present. He cannot forget one transaction of the past, because remember, he's going to judge us today for something we did 1,000 years ago. Mordechai and Esther were born to Shaul HaMelech 600 years after he died. Why? Because he was a modest king. 600 years later, Hashem remembered Shaul was a modest person. I'm giving him the gift today. Mordechai and Esther from his children, and they will save the whole Jewish nation. Thanks to them, we are here. So technically, thanks to Shaul. If Hashem would forget things, it's not fair. Some people will get what they deserve, the other people will not get. Some people will get their punishment, other people will not get the punishment. If you have a problem of forgetfulness, or you have a problem of not analyzing the entire present simultaneously, and you have a limitation about the future, you can never be a fair judge. You cannot give everyone exactly what they deserve. You can never do it. And this is all guarantees in the Torah. I pay everyone exactly what they deserve, for good and for bad. I control everything, and everything is in my hand. And every decision I make is 100% only based on what you do and what you choose. Ein isurim belo chet, the Gemara say. You suffering, it's something you did in the past. What? Dig, investigate. You don't find, maybe it's because bitul Torah. You're not learning enough Torah. That's enough already. You don't learn enough Torah, you deserve all the suffering in the world. For that alone, everything else you can check and investigate. Well, I learn 10 hours a day. Someone with a brain like you, I gave you such a gift, you should learn 15 a day. 15 hours, not 10. You can do it easily, a little bit more effort. But I wrote 2 books. You should have wrote 20. Why only 2? Why only 2? You did not fulfill your potential. But I'm giving tons of money for tzedakah. What you give is nothing compared to how much you should give. How much you give? I give $20 million to tzedakah. And how much you made over the years? Over $1 billion. $20 million from $1 billion, it's a joke. You should have given $900 million and leave $100 million to you and your family. It's more than enough. More than enough to live very, very comfortable. You, your children, your... Why you didn't give $900 million to Torah, to save souls, to make Baalei Tshuva, to send Jewish kids to get Jewish education? Why didn't do it? Ah, you see, what you think you are doing right, if you check carefully, most of the time you find you did not even reach the red line. This is what's going on today. So if something goes wrong, the last thing you should do is complain. The other way, you should say, thank you, Hashem, that it's only this. You have no idea how much I thank you that this is my only suffering. Thank you. Thank you that you have so much mercy on me. No matter what happened to you, you just, God forbid, had an accident, you broke your both legs. 6 months, you won't be able to walk. Your business will go bankrupt. You won't enjoy life. Your games, your running, your jogging, walking up the stairs, going up to your bedroom, everything is a mess now. Say, thank you, Hashem. Thank you so much that I'm not dead, that you settled on only this. Thank you so much. You have nothing to lose. If you complain, your situation will get worse. So you cannot win. So the best thing when you come and say to Hashem, thank you that it's only this, right away Hashem comes back to the Satan, and see, you see what a tzaddik, he accepts his suffering with love. If this is not faith in me, what is faith? Right away, mercy on you. Instead of 6 months suffering, only 3 months. Magic. 3 months later, you're walking. How come? I don't know, Chasdei Hashem. What caused that? Saying thank you. I appreciate it's only this. You lost $10 million now. You had 20, you lost 10. You're very nervous. Wow, it took me 10 years to save it. Thank you, Hashem. Thank you, it's only money. Thank you, I didn't get cancer. Millions of people have cancer. Thank you, it's only money. Thank you, my children didn't die. Thank you, one of my kids doesn't have cancer. I'll be in a hospital for 6 months, day and night. Thank you that this, thank you that, thank you that I have a wife. How many millions of people in the world don't have a wife? They're dying to get married or a husband. Thank you, thank you, millions of thank you, we owe Hashem every minute. If that's the right approach, only good things coming to you. Why? Because the Satan has no reason to instigate between you and Hashem. It's not gonna work for you. If someone keeps saying to his father, I love you, thank you, thank you, I love you, thank you, I love you. If somebody else, the neighbor come and try to make war between the son and the father, it's going to help. This is what we say in the tefillah, Chatom pe satan ve'al yastin alenu. Block the mouth of the Satan that he won't be able to instigate about us. Chatom pe satan ve'al yastin alenu ze'om bo ve'idom. Be tough with the Satan that he should be silent. He should be silent. What? Hu yagid yoshrenu. Instead of speaking negative about us, the Satan will become our defense attorney. Did it ever happen in a court that the prosecutor said to the judge, excuse me, Your Honor, on this one, I don't think that he should get any punishment. We did check and he's really a nice guy. He helps the community. You know, he's very good. He has an orphanage home. He spends a lot of money there. I don't think you should give him any punishment. So the judge will say to him, excuse me, are you the prosecutor or are you the defense? You're supposed to show me the bad about him, not the good. When you see that the prosecutor already suggesting a discount in your jail time, obviously it's a miracle, right? This is what we say in the tefillah. So let's move on. So now, the elders of Moab stayed overnight, and Hashem came to him and started with a question. And Bilam came to the conclusion that Hashem has a problem. He doesn't understand or doesn't know always the future. So maybe I can play tricks on him. So he said, Balak sent people to ask me to curse the nation of Israel. Hashem said to him, don't walk with them. Bilam says, so can I curse from here? Can I curse them from here? How can Bilam be so stupid? How? If you speak to Hashem, right? How can you be so stupid that you ask him permission to curse his own children? Huh? It's like someone comes to his neighbor and says, I came to break the head of your son. Where is he? He said, you're not gonna touch him. You touch him, you have a problem with me. Okay, so can I go and shoot at him from my house? From the balcony over there? Sounds a little bit stupid. So I told you not to touch him. What are you asking me here or there? Do you really think Bilam is so stupid? One thing, the Arabs praying every day to Hashem to help them to kill his children. That's not stupidity. I don't know what other stupidity you're going to find worse than this. But that's Arabs. But Bilam, was he that dumb to ask Hashem permission to curse them? If Hashem came to me, I'm not exactly Moshe Rabbeinu. If Hashem came to me, that's not something that happens every day. That means he's upset at me that these people are here. What part you don't get? How does he ask Hashem, should I curse them from here? Why? Because Hashem didn't say to him, don't curse them. Hashem said, don't go. He's clever. Hashem is very precise in his language. Hashem, if Hashem didn't want me to curse them, all he had to say, don't dare to curse them. End of story. But Hashem didn't tell me, don't curse them. Hashem said, don't go with them. Meaning, they're not to your honor. They should have sent someone much more to your honor. You're the prophet of billions of goyim, no? You are written in my Torah. What is this? Let them send a red rag, an orchestra with trumpets. Tam, tam, ta, tam, you know? Bilam, please come to Moab. When you get off the plane, all the ministers gonna stand over there. This is the way he understands. Why, Rabotai? Because the person in life hears what he wants to hear. Remember this. I see from my lectures what I say and what people understand. I see what the righteous understand, and I see right away what the wicked understand. You understand? I give you one perfect example. When I said many times in my lectures that the punishment of breaking Shabbat is worse punishment than being a murderer, the righteous people understood, whoa. That means that to break Shabbat is a bigger sin than to actually kill someone. Even though to kill is a horrible sin, but to be mechalel Shabbat is just as bad and more. The wicked understand, oh, if that's the case, I might as well kill also. That's what they say. Oh, you say in your lecture that the punishment of to be mechalel Shabbat is worse than to be a murderer. So in that case, why should we not become murderers? That's how the wicked think. Instead of be shaken up and say, wow, you shocked me. I didn't know that's what the Torah saying. Can you prove to me that you're not lying? Where does it say it in the Torah? Then I will give them the source. Then they would read in the Torah that the punishment of mechalel Shabbat is bigger than the punishment of a murderer. Then they would come back to me and say, as much as I hate it, I have to admit that it's really written in the Torah. And now I understand that my actions being mechalel Shabbat is really, really bad. I didn't know it's so bad. I'm gonna work on it. That's the righteous way. But the wicked never reply like this. They always look for the negative, how they can make things worse. That's how it always goes. You see how the righteous react, and you see how the wicked react. If Hashem would come to Moshe in this scenario, Moshe would understand right away not to mess with anything. He didn't need to play games with Hashem. Okay, so can I curse from here? No. Right away we get the point. But Bilam say, if Hashem say to me, don't go with them, let me check things around. Let's see how I can play to get something out of the bargain. So can I curse from here? Can I curse from here? Hashem said, don't curse the nation of Israel. Bilam continue. So let me bless them. Why is he saying this now? He's not exactly a lover of the Jewish nation, right? Now he's saying, so I want to bless them. So let me bless them. Why did Bilam say now, I want to bless them? What's the psychology behind it? Let's see who got the point here. What's the psychology here? Someone comes to you and say, hey, Yosef, I heard you planning to help Reuven to burn my car. You say to him, no, can I help you to guard your car? What's behind it? Why all of a sudden I give him such an offer? Come, let me help you guard your car. Huh? To show you it's nothing personal. I'm not an antisemite. I don't want to curse the Jews. I only do business, parnasa, kadosh baruch hu, parnasa. I make a living. It's parnasa. Okay. So Hashem say, don't bless them. Lo mi duvshach velo mi uktzach. What does it mean, lo mi duvshach? Not from your honey and not from your stinging. The bee has two things in it. It gives honey in one hand, the other hand it can kill you. Some people are allergic to it. One bee comes, and you're done. It sting you and you can die. Or if not, at least it's painful. So Hashem said, we don't need you stinging us and we don't need you giving us honey. We'll manage without you. Don't do us a favor. What's the problem? Why Hashem doesn't want him to bless them? Why? So what's the problem? So why do I care? Somebody weak and thinks, thanks to him, the Jewish nation is successful. Right? If you ask Hussein Obama today, he will tell you, I helped Israel. He won't tell you, I did everything I can to help Iran and destroy Israel. So who cares what he thinks? The answer is, when wicked people, famous wicked people bless us, Hashem is forced not to make the blessing happen, because it's Chilul Hashem. When Lavan and Betuel blessed their Rivka before she went with Eliezer, they blessed her that she will have many children who will turn into a large nation. What was the results of their blessing? That Hashem made her barren. Why? Because if he will make her right away become pregnant and have a lot of kids, all the idol worshippers and the wicked people would say, thanks to Lavan and Betuel, these two crooks, the blessing of the crooks works. So as results of that, Hashem made her barren. Meaning, if they would not say anything, maybe she would have a baby a year later. I mean, she was very young, she couldn't have babies. Once she became a woman and officially was able to be with Yitzchak, right away she became pregnant. Because they gave the blessing, she had to be barren. And there's other examples like this in the Tanakh. So better not to get a blessing from a wicked person. But a wicked person who is known to the public, and it's also known that he gave the blessing. If he doesn't known to the public and nobody knows he gave the blessing, you're allowed to get it from him. The Gemara say, don't ever disrespect a blessing of a simple person, idiot. You can say the Gemara didn't speak about wicked people. The Gemara just spoke about ordinary Jews. He's not a Talmid Chacham, he's not something righteous. He's an average Jew. The Gemara didn't mean someone who's Mechalel Shabbat or an idol worshiper or a murderer. Someone like this, his blessing is always a curse. Possible, you can say that. But one way or the other, the Gemara say, don't ever disrespect a blessing of an ordinary person. You never know. You come to a place, you do a favor to someone, the woman bless you. May Hashem give you this and give it. All of a sudden, you get it. After many years, you couldn't have it. Why? It was a moment of positive moment. Et ratzon. All of a sudden, it worked out. So Hashem said, I don't need your blessing. Don't curse and don't bless. Bilam does not want to tell them that Hashem forbid him to go with them. So he said to them, Hashem did not agree that I will go with such simple ministers like you. It's not honoring me enough. Why did Bilam give them such an answer? One way to understand, that's what he understood. Why Hashem didn't tell me right away, don't care. He told me, don't go. Right? So that's one way to understand. He understands what he wants to understand. Second, many times we answer something that is incorrect. What is the reason for it? Why not saying the truth? What's the reason? Ego, exactly. 100% ego issues. If I say to you, I'm controlled by Hashem, meaning I'm nothing. I have to do what he tells me to do. I don't want to present myself as nothing. I want to be Mandeh Amar, to make my own decision and to show you that I control things. I'm not a puppet that Hashem is moving me. Talk, don't talk, say, walk, don't walk. If that case, who am I? I'm nothing. Moshe Rabbeinu, totally opposite. He said, I'm nothing. Why are you complaining against us? We are nothing. Me and Aaron are nothing. We only do what Hashem told us to do. Why are you complaining about us? He didn't say we are something. We are nothing. So they go back to Balak. They say what Bilam said. He sends a more important minister. Don't worry about it. We give you all the honor in the world and lots of money. Just come and cares. Bilam now has a problem. He has to admit that he's in the hand of Hashem. Now, did Bilam, who was the God of Bilam? Who was his God? Oh. Who was his God? Who was the God of the Arabs? The God of the Torah. Who is the God of the Christians? The God of the Torah. They just made up a stupid story that he has a son. But everybody understands it's the God who created the world. Who is the God of the Chinese or the Hindus or the Buddhists? Who is their God? The God of the Torah? No? In India, they have thousands of gods. Do you know who the gods in India? Indian people. The nation nominate you to be a god. Who is the god of the Buddhists? No. Do they believe that Buddha is a god? No. 2,400 years ago, Buddha was a man. He came and said that he had an enlightenment. He saw the light. So they believe that he's something special. They don't say he's god. I'm not an expert in Buddhism. The little I read about it, that he came and claimed that he saw the light. Nobody ever witnessed it. Based on his story, some people started to follow him. But they didn't claim that he's the God who made the world. But the God of the Quran, same God. They even bring what he said about taking us out of Egypt and bringing us to the promised land, clearly. And in the New Testament, the same thing. In the New Testament, he speaks about the gays, very strictly against them. The criminals against God and this. You understand? This part, I guess, the priests in the churches that do all kinds of bad things, they didn't read. They didn't come to school. When they learned Christianity, 1 week they took off when they got to that chapter. Okay, anyway, just to give you an idea, everyone agreed. Christians, Muslims, and Jews all agree about the identity of God. No question about it. Okay. In the website of the Hamas, they call God the God of Israel. And when they speak about King David, they say, Daoud, peace be on him. Israel, meaning Jacob, peace be on him. All the prophets, peace be on him. They're not denying Judaism, Torah, prophets, everything 100%. They just claim there's another book. The only problem is that the new book is totally opposite of the first book, which shows it's not from God. So now, who was the God of Bilam? Huh? He believes in Hashem only or in other gods as well? Who was the god of Lavan? Who was the god of Lavan? Lavan Arami. Huh? The Torah said that he was an idol worshiper. When Eliezer came with the camels full of wealth, he said, Piniti et habayit. I cleared the room for you. The Gemara said, which room was that? Room with all his statues, where he bowed down to his statues, like the Mexican in Mexico do. They have a lot of little dolls that they put on the table with candles and they bow down to it.
Ruch.
Huh?
Ruch has fit on his girl.
Yeah. So the question is, it said, Piniti et habayit. Why? He wants the money and all the wealth to come in. This is the way of the wicked people. As soon as they see money, they throw God out of their house and out of their life. He had a room for his gods. He believed that they bring him good. He prayed to them every day. Eliezer came with camels full of good. He threw the gods right away to the garage. Bring everything in. You know, when I was a few times in Europe, especially in Belgium, when you walk into the houses of the people, the entrance is double on the height from here. Very, very high. All the gates, very, very high. Who needs such tall doors? Then when you dig and check the history of all these places, some of them are 300-400 years old. The buildings. So many, so old, 200 years old. From the time they used to have horses, carriages. Now in the winter, where are they gonna put the horses? They put them in. How are they gonna let them in? They're tall. They're very high. They need a door to let the animals in. Now, where are they gonna put them in the snow? They'll die. Here, everything is modern, so they put small doors. Who are you gonna put, your puppy? Don't need such a big door. By the way, I want to ask you a question. Bilam was the most important goy in the world, right? He was a Congress member. He was the advisor of Hussein Obama, working for him. He's one of his three right-hand men. Paro, the Hitler of that generation, had three advisors. One of them was Yitro, one of them was Bilam, right? And the third one was Eov. Bilam is the most wicked one out of them. He's the one who gave him the advice to kill the Jewish babies. Eov and Yitro, when he heard that, he ran away. Eov was quiet. He didn't say yes, he didn't say no. And Bilam said, kill them, of course. Now I want to ask you a question. Person like this that is known as a prophet of the goyim. He is a magician. He is an advisor of the king of the biggest empire in the world. So everyone respects him, no? How is he riding on a donkey? He couldn't afford a horse?
Huh?
It's a very good point what he says. It's like today, some rebbes, they have very simple cars. Few hundred dollar lease. Some rebbes have very expensive cars. Baal Shem Tov, where he started Hasidut. He was the ultimate Hasid. If you want to be a Hasid, you have to be a Hasid like the Baal Shem Tov had in mind. Simple, down to earth, not materialistic, none of the things that penetrate to our lives today. You understand? If you want to be a Chabadnik, original Chabadnik, you have to be a Chabadnik like Baal HaTanya, over 200 years ago. He's the founder of the Chabad movement. You have to go to the original one. You want to be a Hasid, you have to follow the Baal Shem Tov. He is the founder of Hasidut. See what he had in mind for Hasidut and see what you are now. and you may find that you are the total opposite of the Baal Shem Tov. You may be very surprised. What you think is Hasid and what Baal Shem Tov had in mind is totally opposite. Check yourself. You want to belong to a group, you have to follow the Ten Commandments of the group. Right? You want to follow the Torah. You have to go to the Chumash. That's the original source. What written later on, it's all important. But the first thing you have to learn is the Chumash. What do they teach in Yeshiva? First Chumash or first Gemara? First Chumash. Then Mishnah. And after the Mishnah, Gemara. Okay, there's right order. If you want to be a Chabadnik, you have to follow the Baal HaTanya, who was very, very strict. And he spoke about Gehenom, and punishment, and fake people, and wicked people, and was a very holy Kabbalist. Read Baal HaTanya. Read his book, see what a legendary big holy Chacham he was. And you will find out that what you think is Chabad, and what Baal HaTanya thought is Chabad, is totally opposite. Not even one thing connects to Baal HaTanya today. Nothing. Read some of his writing. And you see there's no connection between what they do today to what their father, the first Rebbe, did. If you want to be Breslev, you have to stick to one book. Likutei Moharan. That's the book was written in the life of Rabbi Nachman Mibreslev. Everything else was written after he passed. Maybe he said it, maybe not, we will never know. This was written in his lifetime. You understand? If you want to be a Hasid of Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, you can go by the books that was written in his lifetime, while he was alive. What was written after he passed, maybe he said it, maybe not. You will never know. Chelek Aleph and Chelek Bet of Or Letzion, Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul sat together with Rav Amar, one of his Talmidim, and went through every question and answer. After that, Chelek Gimel and Dalet and the rest, he already passed. They took it from the notebooks of his student. Maybe that's what he meant, maybe not. We will never know. Same thing Rav Ovadia. If somebody will continue the series of Rav Ovadia, even one of his sons, whatever they're going to write will never be 100% reliable like the book of Rav Ovadia wrote with his own life. Or Rav Eliashiv or anyone else. Make sense what I say? Okay. Who is the God of this Bilam?
Donkey.
Why does he ride on a donkey? So Yair say, he's putting up a show. You know these people walk like this, humble, pretending, and as soon as you offend them, they're ready to murder you. One person, somebody stepped on his foot in shul, pushed him away. Oof, nudnik! Lama ta lo roe lan ta olech? Watch where you walk! Rabbi Ben Zion came to him and said to him, can I ask you a question? Yesterday was his yortzeit, Rabbi Ben Zion Abba Shaul zechutot again alenu. He said to him, can I ask you a question? He says, didn't you just daven now 2 minutes ago? ונפשי כאפר לכל תהיה. Make my spirit sand, dust, in front of everyone. Meaning, make me nothing. I'm nothing. Every day you lie like this in a davening. 2 minutes later, someone accidentally step on your leg. You want to kill it. What happened, נפשי כאפר לכל תהיה? I want to ask you a question. Which verse from Tfilat Shmona Esre, if I had the power, I would erase. We don't have the power to change anything, obviously. Don't get the wrong idea. But if I had the power, hypothetically speaking, if I was Rabbi Akiva, if, million time if, and I had the power to make a suggestion in the davening to Anshei HaKnesset HaGdola, which pasuk I would erase? In the end of the davening, what do we say? Before we say, Oseh Shalom Bimromav, We say, יהיו לרצון אמרי פי והגיון ליבי לפניך. What does it mean, יהיו לרצון? Everything I just wished for and prayed for should be welcomed by you, Hashem. You willingly accept it. והגיון ליבי, and my thoughts as well. Now, I want to ask you a question. Do you know one person that when he begins to daven 18 does not circle the world at least 18 times? China, Japan, Borough Park, Flatbush, Monsi, Lakewood, Israel, my uncle, my cousin, business, customer is on the way. Subway, what time, my flight, tomorrow. One Chacham said, all the shidduchim I made came to me in the middle of Tfilat 18. Huh? Chazonish. Chazonish. So then he said, I accepted on myself not to offer the shidduchim that comes to me anymore in Tfilat 18. Right? It's not coming in a right way. So like this, if I won't use it, what's the point of thinking about it? Understand? So I want to ask a question, help us, Chacham. Why Bilam rides on a donkey? So Yair say, puts a show. It's a very good way to show I'm humble. But the Gemara said that he was very, very arrogant and very proud. The Gemara say, if you want to be from the student of Avraham Avinu, you have to be generous. You have not to be jealous, to have low spirits, to be humbled. And if you are from the group of Bilam, you are jealous and arrogant, and you don't want anyone to have anything, and you are full of ego and pride. Why? Because that's your teacher, Bilam. He was like that. So everybody knows you're already full of pride. What are you putting a show now with a donkey? The answer is, Rabotai, this story of Bilam, when exactly it happened? Shortly after the exodus of Egypt, right? Bnei Israel are in a desert. Few months ago, a few years ago, they were in Egypt in slavery. What happened before they came out of Egypt? Hashem killed all their animals. All the animals that you leave outside, Hashem killed them. Who are the only Egyptians that have horses left? The one that pushed them into the house before the plague arrived. It's written in the Torah. Those who fear the warning of Hashem made their animals go into the house, meaning they got saved. And those who did not pay attention, all their animals died. It's a clear verse in the Torah. If I ask you, what's the opposite of Yare Shamayim? Kvod Harav, this person, Moshe, is Yare Shamayim, fearful from Hashem. What's the opposite of Yare Shamayim? Arrogant is proud, is gas ruach, chutzpah. No, nothing to do with Yere Shamayim. What's the opposite of Yere Shamayim? You have black, the opposite of black, white. Right? You have hot, opposite of hot, cold. Right? You have smart, opposite of smart, stupid. Rich, poor. Right? What's the opposite of Yere Shamayim? You have humble, proud. Right? Humble, proud. So there's opposites that are very clear in life. If you're not this, you are this. What's the opposite of a person that has Yirat Shamayim? He's such a Yere Shamayim. How do you say about a person that is the total opposite of Yere Shamayim? According to the Torah. Not an atheist. First of all, I want you to know, I promise you, there's not one atheist in the whole world. You will never find, it's all a lie. Connect them to a lie detector, the machine will go on smoke. There's no such thing an atheist, you know why? Because if you tell an atheist, do you believe that this book was printed by itself? The ink spilled from the table, and all the words and the lines and the letters all came in the right order and made a book. What the atheist will say to you, I'm calling my psychiatrist. You need right away a mental institution, right? Then you will answer to this fool, I need a psychiatrist? You say the whole world was made by itself. I only say the book was made by itself. One tiny book. You say the whole brain was made by itself. 10 trillion connection, much more than the amount of letters in a book. So who's the dumb between us? They don't believe about it. They all believe the world has a creator. Who is the creator? That's a matter of education. Some of them learn Torah, so they believe it's Hashem. Some of them don't know who it is. Like one guy in my film, they interview him on the street, in my Divine Information film, do you believe in God? I don't know who he is, but definitely there's some kind of a superpower who made everything here and run the show. That's what most of the Chilonim think. Some of them believe in God. They say the word God. In Israel, it's become an illegal word now. You have to be really brave to say Be'ezrat Hashem. If you're in the Israeli Knesset, there used to be 20 years that none of the prime minister in Israel agreed to say the word Be'ezrat Hashem. That's how wicked they used to be. Who used to say Be'ezrat Hashem Elat? Menachem Begin, Alav HaShalom. It was a righteous man, Shomer Shabbat, Eating Kasher, Baki in the Tanakh, and the most honest person you will meet. My friend was married to his granddaughter, and he was learning Tanakh with him Elat when he went to his house or when he was in the hospital. He told me that the bodyguards say that they never saw in their life such an honest person like Menachem Begin. He said, when we used to go to places, hotel, overseas, when we used to leave the hotel rooms, he was asking all the bodyguards if they shut the air condition and the lights in the hotel, if they shut it off. So why? We don't know. We'll go check. Why making someone lose money for no reason? Was worried about the money of the goyim in the hotel over there. That's how honest he was with money, not God forbid to receive any bribe or anything he doesn't deserve. You have some people like this. But that's it, that's just about it. From all the prime ministers we had, one of them was lover of Hashem, Ohev Tanakh, Ohev Emet, okay, Shomer Shabbat. Everybody else, all Mechalelei Shabbat. But this one, Bibi, is one leg over here, one leg over there. Very good politician, you know? When it comes to the religious people, our strength is the Torah. I will never let anyone hurt the yeshivot. When it comes to these wicked people, I will not let the Talmidei yeshivot take advantage on us no longer. So you don't know what he is. It's like a leopard. When it's on the grass, it's green. When it's on the sand, it's brown. Depend where you go. Top. But who was Bilam? The opposite of Yeresh HaMayim in the Torah is, ladies and gentlemen, get ready, not paying attention to the warning of Hashem. That's what's written in the Torah. The Torah says, those who feared God push their animals into the house. The Torah didn't say those who did not fear God. Because everybody fear God. So if you see someone who does not fear God, it's not because he's not afraid of God. Of course, everyone. Who wants God to start with him? You're afraid of the IRS, you're not afraid of God, come on. Those who did not pay attention to the warning, like most of us, Don't pay attention. יום מחלל שבת. I'm sure Hashem love me. It's merciful. It's not so bad. I'll do תשובה. Don't worry. I'm young. Do not pay attention to the word of the speaker. Read the Tanakh, but don't pay attention to what happened to wicked people like you. If you would pay attention, you would faint. Every one of us, if you open the Tanakh and read what happened to hundreds of people that are not even 1% wicked like we are, not even 1%, what huge, horrible hand they had, then you will understand how critical is our situation. One best example is Moshe Rabbeinu. Did he ever make a sin? Few little tiny mistakes. The dream of his life exploded in his face. He never entered Israel after 4 years of suffering for this moment. If it would happen to us, today, if you meet a girl and you love each other and you date for a few months, and you get engaged, and a week or two before the wedding, she changed her mind. I came to the conclusion we're not gonna be a good husband and wife. I want out, take your ring back. By some Ashkenazim, it's so critical, they get married and get divorced. They say it's better than to break a shidduch. I myself don't understand the logic here. You have to ask them who told them to do such thing. But that's how bad it is to break a shidduch. I don't have to tell you how it break the heart of a man or the girl if the other side cancel. After you live in such a dream and you're so happy for 6 months and next week is your wedding and you finally have a wife and you're finally not gonna be alone and you're gonna have children in a few years, all of a sudden it explodes in your face. Meaning 6 months was all illusion. It was all an illusion. The illusion exploded in your face. Some people do not come out of depression until the day they die. They never get married after that. Broken heart. And I know a few people like this. Imagine Moshe Rabbeinu, 40 years of illusion, not 6 months. Soon I'm gonna enter the Holy Land. My dream comes through. And what happened? For tiny thing that he did for the sake of heaven, not for himself. Hashem say he won't enter Israel. Why? You eat the rock instead of talking to the rock. For this you don't let me in? Not Moshe Rabbeinu. Okay, that's what Hashem wants, that's what Hashem wants. Yaakov Avinu. Yaakov Avinu. Such a righteous man. Such a devotion in learning Torah. Such a perfect tzaddik. The founder of the Jewish nation. His son Yosef. He thought he died. Kidnapped. The best son he had. His wife died in her 30s. His daughter Dina was raped by a goy. Hunger. His brother came with 400 men to kill him. He has to hide 20 years. 20 years he walked like a slave to a wicked crook. This Lavan, the idol worshiper. Imagine this. Today people go to their in-laws, and their in-laws are not religious. One Shabbat with their in-laws, they want to commit suicide. Who gets the call on Sunday? Me. Rabbi, please talk to my wife. I cannot go to her parents anymore. It's a nightmare. You don't know how much I suffer. Yaakov Avinu, 20 years living with this crook. How he kissed his idols, how he tricked him every day, doesn't pay him. Tricked him with Leah, give him Leah. All this suffering Yaakov had. In a billion years, we won't reach the level of Yaakov Avin. So what's gonna be with us? If such a tzaddik suffered so much, for what? What did he do wrong? Dig! Take a tweezer, you know? Look around, maybe you find one reason. I don't know if you find. How much he suffered? Avraham Avinu, Ishmael, all these things that happens. Yitzchak, had a son like this, Esav, fooling him all his life. Abba, how do you make maaser from the salt? Fooling him. Big arguments. The Chachamim don't know how to understand the relationship between Yitzchak and Esav. Doesn't make sense. You can fool someone like Yitzchak, come on. Person doesn't know who his son for so many years. How many years your son can fool you? One, two, three. Eventually you know exactly who he is. It's enough you see his haircut, you know who your son is. Your son lived in your house, he went to yeshiva in Israel. Or your daughter, he comes back here later. I don't need more than half a second to know if he's on the way up or if he's on the way down. It's enough I see his haircut, I know exactly who he is. I don't even need to ask him how was it in Eretz Israel. You see a chassid that trim his beard, you know he's on the way down. Even though there's no obligation from the Torah to have a long beard. But by the chassidim, it's a holy thing. That's one of the most important things. You want to be a chassid, condition number one, beard and long peot. You cut, even though from the Torah it's not a sin. You can trim your beard from the Torah. You're not allowed to shave with a razor. But because you are a part of chassidut, and you know by us is very holy, doing it is rebelling against what we are. That's it. Like the Hasidish Belzer Rebbe told me, by us Hasidim, it's better that you will be Mechalel Shabbos than you stop dressing like a Hasid. That's what he told me. Of course, I disagree with what he said, but it just gives us an idea that the image is very important by us, because the image is telling me if you're still connected to Hashem and to our tradition, or you already porek all. Mechal el Shabbos, so you can do tshuva. If you already begin to dress different and you don't want anything to do with us, who knows where we're gonna find you in a year or two. A lot of common sense here. You understand? That's why you see that the most serious Bnei Torah, you'll never find them wear any shirt but white. Why? What's the problem wearing light blue or a little bit yellow, I don't know, other colors? Technically, no problem. But because it became the uniform of the Bnei Torah, anyone who does otherwise, that means something is not right in this person's ideology. Don't hold it to the shirt. The shirt is not the point. The point is that he has the guts to declare to everyone, I'm different than you. I'm learning Gemara all day, I'm steiging. But I don't want to be 100% like you. So his hat will be different or something else. You understand? This is it, Rabotai. This is big, deep psychology that shows a lot about the person. You look at the person with his hair all the way up, you know something in his nefesh is not right. Why? Because the Zohar speaks very much about men that wants to grow long hair. That's why the Hasidim, they shave their children hair the shortest way possible. Why? Because hair, it's impurity. It's tuma, it's dinim. It's judgment on a person. You can argue how short he has to be. And everybody agreed that if it's like some of these kids that you see them, on one hand they have a black hat, on the other hand their blorit is higher than this bottle. I saw one on Shabbat in a shul. If I had the guts, I would come pull it out of his head. I couldn't focus on the davening when I saw that kid with such a blorit. Now what can you do? Teenagers. Not to talk about people that have all this long hair. I went one time to a Brit Milah somewhere, and I saw one person with beard, but long hair in the back. I heard him talking with a Hasidish accent, you know. I said to myself, this guy probably is a singer. 2 minutes later, I see he grabbed the microphone. I said, why did he have this? I'm different, I'm a singer, I'm a celebrity. Long hair in the back. Carly Bach style. That's probably his hero, he imitates him. That's what we... Most of us imitate someone. You should know that. Some people that watch a lot the goyim, they imitate the goyim. People who watch holy rabbis, they want to imitate the holy rabbis. Perfectly natural. What you admire, that's what you imitate. Some religious kid watch all day basketball and they see the black basketball stars. They don't only imitate them when they play basketball. They imitate them when they talk. They begin to talk in their accent. Why all of a sudden you speak with a black accent? What happened to you? Yiddish is not good for you anymore. That is hero. That's who is identified with. Ask some of the kids. I have 100 cards of Gdole Israel. Rav Eliashiv, Rav Shach, Rav Uvadia, or Rav Vosner, all these big tzaddikim. Or I have 100 cards of LeBron and his friends. Who do you want to get for free for your birthday? Let's leave the answer as a mystery. You understand? So now, Bilam left his horses outside, his horses died. Maybe he can also put a show that he's a humbled person. So now he's on a donkey. There's one third reason, Yair, we almost forgot. The donkey, officially, it's his wife. He lives with his donkey. Chachamim will not make any lie about anyone. Everything they told you about a Jew happened. Everything they told you about a Goy happened. How do we know? If the Chachamim wanted to make Bilam look bad, they will never write in a Gemara that he was able to reach the level of Moshe Rabbeinu. Yodea Da'at Elyon. They compliment him. They compliment the Goyim in some issues, like the Persians. They are very modest. Or the Gemara brings few stories from Goyim that used to respect their parents, like Dama ben Natina. Why, you couldn't find any Jew that respect his parents? You have to give me an example from a Goy? We are objective. Do you know how the Ashkenazi Sidurs begin? What's the first page in the Ashkenazi Sidur? Who knows? There is a sentence from a famous person in the Torah. What is it? Ma tovu ohalecha Yaakov mishkenotecha Yisrael. Who said this verse? Bilam. You cannot bring something from Moshe Rabbeinu, you have to bring from Yasser Arafat to start the Ashkenazi Shidur with such a murderer, filthy person that lives with his donkey. You couldn't find us anyone holy. Holy mouth that say something. Why you have to start the Sidur with such a Rasha Merusha? There are a few reasons for it. One is to show you that everything came out of his mouth was Hashem, not him. You can see, it's Hashem turned it all to a blessing. If you keep saying, we don't want to quote anything from Bilam, that means you're not questioning Bilam, you're questioning Hashem. Second reason I saw in one of the books, to teach you a very important rule in Judaism and in life. Don't be a politician. The truth is above politics. What's the connection between these two politics? What's the difference between a kosher holy rabbi to a successful politician? One major difference. Between them. I'm talking a real rabbi. Real kosher rabbi. What's the difference between when the rabbi gives a speech and when the politician gives a speech? Very good. Politician will say what you want to hear or what will bring him more votes and money in the time of election. Regardless of what he believes in. If he's anti-gay, but he comes to the gay parade, all people are equal, you have the right for this, and you should have marriage, and you should have children. Then he comes to his wife at home, ach, I should kill them, these guys, I can't stand them. Boy, you just gave a speech 2 hours ago. What do you expect me to say? I hate you. I want all of you, you know, whatever happened. I can't. I have to say what I need their votes. He hates Jews. He comes to a synagogue to speak before Rosh Hashanah. They invite him. It's very good for me. Another 200,000 Jews with big money in New York will vote for me, even though my name is Hussein. So when I come to speak to the liberal Jews, what do I say? I say things they like to hear. We will never let Iran have a bomb. The safety of Israel is very important to us. On my dead body, someone will go against Israel. The relationship with Israel in my days will be the best it ever been. Give me the votes and the money, and then I'll stab you in the back. That's politician. Like the famous joke I once said, that one politician died, and Hashem said to him, I have a very big dilemma. I have to send you to hell for 500 years for the way you were. But on the other hand, 5 million people voted for you. It's very problematic, because you have a lot of fans. So I tell you what, I'm going to give you a special visa. Go and check heaven, check hell, tell me where you like to be. You can go there. So he said, okay, where would you like to start? He said, of course, hell. I want to see hell first. So they take him to hell. He see people play guitar, siman tov, mazal tov, cocktail, pineapple juice, lake, jet ski, dancers. So this is hell, yeah. Wow, look at this, such beautiful views. Tropical trees, delicious great whiskey. Wow, Kugel. What they call it, these things that they love so much. No, what's the? Yapchik. Yapchik. Gefilte fish. Yapchik is very delicious Hasidish thing. So, he says, this is hell. I sign. Okay, now you want to see heaven? Yeah, he takes him to heaven. 100,000 people with white shirts, gemarot open, arguing what this Rav saying, the other Rav did not agree, how come? I'm allergic. Quick, quick. I can't look at these people. Take me out of here. You sure? Okay, sign, you don't like this place. Right away, sign. Take me back to hell. They opened the curtain, pushed him in. Where is the lake? Where is the whiskey? All fire. Terrible Auschwitz with smoke. People are screaming, pain, dead bodies everywhere. Boom, he bang on the door. Open! That's not the place! That's hell! What did you expect? You show me a band, you show me dancers, a lake. This was before the election. Now it's after the election. You understand? What you did to your voters, we did to you. Mida keneged mida. That was before the election. Now it's after the election. So, the question now, how did we get to the election? Oh, so now the job of the rabbi, the job of the rabbi is to tell people the truth, whether they like him, whether they will hate him for that, whether they will come next lecture, whether they will stop to come, whether they will invite him again, whether they'll put him in a band, whether they will buy his books or whether they will burn his books, whether they will write nice things about him in the internet or whether they're gonna make all kinds of lies about him, whether they will give him donations to his yeshiva in activity or whether they will stop his donations. This is all not relevant. You have to represent the Torah in the right way. This is the truth and that's it. What will happen later, it's not up to me anymore. If Hashem wants me to have funds to continue, fine. If not, I retired. I'm anus. Why stop giving lecture? I didn't have money. Why I didn't have money? Nobody donated. Why you didn't give lecture? Nobody invites me. Why nobody invites me? Because I spoke very strict and I told them exactly what's going to be their end. So they hated me. So they didn't invite me. Okay. I give you a V. It counts like you did all of that. You anus. Anus, Rachmanah, Patre. You don't get a punishment. You will, however, get a huge punishment misrepresenting my truth to gain popularity, or money, or fans, or to have a lot of speeches. I will punish you severely for changing one word of my Torah. And that's what will happen to most of the speakers in the world today. They will have the worst punishment even more than the secular people in the next world. Why? If something Hashem hates the most is someone that dare to change his Torah even one letter. Who knows what's written in the Torah for someone who add or decrease one letter from the Torah, needless to say, a word or a sentence or a chapter, intentionally. What's the punishment for that in the Torah? For modifying the Torah even by one letter. What's the punishment? Death penalty. Death penalty. Someone on purpose modified the Torah, death penalty. So, we mean well. We want people to love the Torah, but we forget that Hashem knows people better than us. And when he gave the Torah, he saw all the generations, include the liberal Jews and all the traders and the Torah haters, and he still wrote the Torah the way he wrote it, knowing they will bark non-stop against the Torah. But he could care less about them. Let them hear and bark, and I will take care of them when they die. I don't care what they bark and what they scream. This is the truth, whether they like it or hate it. And your job is to present it the way it is. Don't calculate what's good for me. You are not me. I did not make you my partner. You don't sit with me in a board of education in heaven to decide which parts of the Torah to present and which parts of the Torah to hide. Makes sense to you or no? So why nobody agree when they hear the truth? Why they get angry? Why not to say, you're right, I know that's what the Torah is saying, and I'm not there yet, what can I do? I'm not righteous. What do you want me to tell you? To tell you I'm perfect? I'm not. Why I'm not? I can give you 500 excuses why. You're right, you told me what the Torah says, I trust you, I know it's, that's what it says. And if I'm not sure, I will ask you to give me a source. And after you give me a source, now I know it's there. So now, this is the truth, and I live against the truth. I think it's gonna be much better than to scream at those who present the truth. Because by criticizing them, or making up all kinds of lies about them, you're actually doing it against Hashem, not against them. When you complain against their speeches or against what they wrote or said, you don't complain about them, you complain about Hashem, because they told you what the Torah says. They didn't tell you what they think. They did not mix their own feelings and opinions. They told you exactly what the Torah says. And you don't like the Torah. And you cannot start a war directly against Hashem. So it was very easy to blame the mailman for giving you an invitation for an investigation or to send you a penalty that you have to pay to the motor vehicle. Imagine someone's get a ticket and a mail, open it up, $2,000 tickets you have to pay with penalty and fines. He begins to hit the mailman. Why are you giving me such thing? You're extreme. You fanatic. Don't dare to come here again. The mailman will call Atzala. Somebody needs to be a barbanel right away. You're all laughing, but 70-80% of us are like this. Who are they criticizing? Most of the Jews in the internet don't care Hashem. Some do, unfortunately. Most of them care so the rabbis. Why they don't curse the writer of the Torah? Why they curse the one who read them? What's the Torah say? Because it's much easier. Much easier. You understand? That's it. I want to finish with one last thing. Hashem said to him technically, if you want to get paid for walking there, it's not my problem. but you won't be able to curse. I'm letting you know that. Because you will say exactly as I tell you. Bilam should have known already he shouldn't go. But he had other plans. Why did Bilam say to Hashem, can I curse them from here? Meaning, do they deserve a curse or no? If yes, let me be the one who benefits from it. When Titus came to destroy Beit HaMikdash, before he destroyed Beit HaMikdash, he made a questionnaire, experiment. He would shoot an arrow to the opposite side, and the arrow would come and turn into the direction of the temple. He came to a Jewish boy. What did you learn today in yeshiva? The boy said a sentence that talks about the destruction of the temple. He did all kinds of things to see if Hashem agree that I will go and burn the temple. Meaning, if the Jews deserve it, I'm doing him a favor. I'm a tzaddik. I do what Hashem said in the Tanakh. After he saw that all answers shows that he has to destroy the temple, he went and destroyed the temple. That's what he did. But before that, he wasn't so sure about it. He made all kinds of experiments. Bilam said, if they deserve a punishment, allow me to curse them. Give them what they deserve. Nobody lose. It's a win-win situation. They get what you want to punish them anyway. And I get paid. I won't do more than what they deserve. Let me curse them from here. Hashem said, don't. Bilam continue. Now the donkey is making him problems. The donkey is pushed to the side of the road. There's a wall there, bricks. He squeezed his leg, smashed his leg. He hit the donkey 3 times. He doesn't know that there's an angel with a sword in front of the donkey blocking the way. How did the donkey see the angel and the Bilam did not see the angel? Huh? Animals see spiritual images that people cannot see. If you have a dog or a cat, many times you will find that you sit in a quiet room, middle of the night, you read something and the cat or the dog is on the corner, all of a sudden you look, you see the dog looking up and begin to cry and to get nervous and to move and to go crazy. You look around, what happened? Nothing, told me it's a mosquito or something. What is the dog so panicking about? They see things that we cannot see. The frequency of the lens of the dogs or other animals work different than our eyes. The Zohar say that if Hashem would give us permission to see all the spiritual images around us, 1 second, all of us would be crazy for life. That's it, mentally sick. We won't be able to stay normal. We would live in paranoia and fear. We'll go crazy. So he hides it from us. Even souls of people that died are in space. Sometimes when you take pictures with a camera or video camera, the lens detect images of souls of people that died. As I showed in my video, Life After Death, in the last 20 minutes of the film, I showed pictures that were captured by people all over the world. And in the picture, they saw images of people that died. Some of them they knew, some were family members. As a matter of fact, when I was in Florida a few years ago, I spoke in a big house. And the topic was life after death. And after I finished the lecture, the owner of the house took me to his bedroom, turned on the computer, and showed me a picture of him and his son sitting in their minivan in the front seat, and an old woman sitting in the back of the minivan in the middle seat. It looked in the picture that she's totally alive. And he said to me, you see, that's my wife's mother. She passed 7 years ago. We took a selfie, me and my son, and my mother-in-law was in the picture inside the car, in the picture with us. And I looked at her face, every line, every wrinkle in her face was so clear. I did not even know it's a soul. It looks much 100% like a person. She passed 7 years ago. In the picture, 100%. And I showed many pictures like this. Some people, they are able to see spiritual things that other people cannot see. Don't ask me why. The answer I can give you is that the Torah says for every rule, there's an exception to the rule. For every few million people, you have one Jew or a non-Jew that look in the air and can see people that died, can see spirits. I know one woman from Queens. She sees on people's forehead all kinds of things. She sees people that died. It's crazy. One time a mother called me that she has a 16 years old daughter that she doesn't know what to do, if I can send her to a Kabbalist. I said, what happened? She said, my daughter's room is upstairs. For a few years, there's a man sitting on her bed. Every night she goes up to sleep. He's sitting like this with a very sad face. And she always tells us that she sees him on the bed and she describes how he looks. We obviously don't see anything. But the girl says, he's here. So I said, okay, so what changed now? So you said that it's been going on for years. She said, that's exactly the point. That last night we started to hear screaming from the room. Me and my husband ran upstairs and we saw that the girl is moving like someone is choking her. We got very nervous, we started to scream. And then she said that the man started to choke her. But until now, he never bothered her. All of a sudden, he's now choking her. So they don't know what to do, how to get rid of the spirit of this person. One time, I had them, was finished with this because time ran out. I didn't finish what I wanted to talk about, but it's always like this, as you all know. And I know I told people that I'm gonna finish by 11, I wanna finish. So one time I had 3 guests in my house, in my other house where I used to live. 3 Israeli men. One of them is a brother of my brother-in-law, okay, which is married to my sister, his brother married to my sister. So he brought 2 of his friends to me for Shabbat. One of them is a parachuter, Israeli Yemenite guy, and one of them is Iraqi guy that thinks that he's God. You know these people? Not less than that. So I have this Yemenite parachuter, very nice, humble person. My brother-in-law, also very nice, humble person, and this guy, Hashem Yirachem. We sit at my table Friday night with other guests. There are only 3 among many. We talk and talk and talk. The name of Rav Ovadia Yosef came up, and this guy that thinks he's a god, so he went crazy when I was complimenting Rav Ovadia Yosef. Why? Because in Israeli media, they constantly murdered his reputation every week. All these wicked people, because he was the most successful rabbi in the world with so many following, and they couldn't stand him because he was also make political decisions. So they constantly, the liberals, lefty, everything against him, nonstop, for years. So he was brainwashed. So as soon as he heard his name, he started to talk against him. He came to a situation, I cannot sit in my house listening to this fool speaking bad against one of the most important righteous people in the world. So I fight with him back. He came to a situation like I'm saying to him, basically, shame on you. And he basically said to me, what do you think? Because I'm your guest, I'm gonna say what you wanna hear? I don't care. So the other guys, they felt very uncomfortable. So they say to him, listen, you're embarrassing us. Enough with this. You don't like him, you don't like him. Why do you have to talk? You're sitting in a rabbi's house, you see that he's speaking nicely about him. Why do you start a fight? So he looked at them, you know what? You are just like him. Threw the chair and went to the room. The room was, I had a long hallway, the last one on the hallway. Not even a minute later, We sit in the Shabbat table, Rabotai, it's in front of a camera. I told that story already in the past. Not even a minute later, we hear from the room such screams, you never heard in your life such scary screams. Ah, but loud. We all got up, we ran to the room, we opened the door, we see him sitting on a bed, his eyes came out like this, and he was moving left and right, so fast, left and right, like this. They wanted to do something. I said, don't touch him. Who knows what it is? Don't touch. Like this for 20 seconds. You okay? You okay? But he doesn't even hear us screaming. Then it stopped, and he was going like this. Like this for 2 minutes. What happened? He cannot talk. He couldn't breathe. He became red like a tomato. And I said to him, you okay? Yeah, I'm okay. Like you saw the devil. What happened? Say someone came, started to choke me. So there's two secular guys. You see what happened when you speak about holy rabbis? You know what happened to this guy? He's the first one from the three became religious. After a few months, I go to Israel. How is this guy? He's giving shiurim in a shul in Ben Ishchai. He found out he's some kind of relative of Ben Ishchai in Iraq. He teach Ben Ishchai in a shul. I said, teach Ben Ishchai? I said, you don't understand. Sit all day, learn, reading books. But you see, there are spiritual things. Not all of us can see it, but some of us do. If you want to get more information about it, watch my film, Life After Death. We'll see you next Tuesday, Bezrat Hashem. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen.